Thank you, Mike. Thank you, George and Joe, for the invitation for this talk. Today, this talk is a joint work with Nicolas Colleges on the back and Constantine Nicolopoulos over there. We're talking about judgment, but from an alternative point of view, not judgmental adjustments that you usually hear about. But before going to the subject, a few people in this conference were asking me about what is the deal with Greeks and forecasting? Why so many Greeks are here? Of course, the response goes some years back, 3,000 years back, right? You know, there was Ithia, the oracle of Delphi, established in 8th century before Christ. So, apparently, this oracle was chewing leaves of Daphne and was burning some leaves holding this plate, right, as you can see in this image. But when I was back in NTUA, in the National Center University of Athens and the Forecasting and Strategy Unit, we did a little bit more research on that. And actually, we found out that what Pythia was holding in her hand was not a plate, was a laptop. So Pythia was not making judgmental predictions back then. She was making statistical predictions. And to the best of my knowledge, she was using a very early release of the forecast package. Since then, the forecast package has been developed a lot. And actually, 4 years ago, Rob Hyman was giving a keynote in Seoul, in this same conference. And he was arguing that maybe it's time that we leave forecasters on the side and we start forecasting without forecasters. And he was presenting some very nice results using his developments in the forecast package. So he was essentially saying that automatic forecasting using ETS, electronic smoothing, or AutoRIMA can go pretty well. But today, we will put a question mark on that. And we will start questioning if this statement is actually correct. So I would like to invite you now to prove Rob Hyman wrong. So here we have a time series. This is a yearly time series from the M3 competition. Of course, I can't make this time series for the purpose of this exercise. So I would like to ask you this question. Which is the best forecast of the two that you are seeing here? Is it the blue forecast or the green forecast? Blue or green, which one is better for this case? And actually, I would like you to ask, take your phone, tablet, laptop, or whatever you have available, and go to www.menti.com, use the password that you can see on the screen, 906880, and hopefully, if technology allows us, we will be able to make this work. So you should see on your screen two options, blue line or green line. And also, I can tell you that blue line is simple exponential smoothing, green line is damped exponential smoothing. So put down your prediction.
Does it allow me to submit the codes?
Right. Do you put spaces, maybe?
With or without spaces?
No spaces.
That would like to
that work for me?
No spaces. No spaces.
Work for you?
Yeah.
All right. Stefan, it's only you. I have blocked you on purpose.
We cannot choose the average.
No, you cannot choose the average. So, it's just the one or the other. You have to make, essentially, the task here is to make judgmental model selection, right? So, to select which one of these two lines is the best. Both lines have been produced with statistical methods. But now, instead of using cross-validation or information criteria to make the selection between the two, I'm asking you to make the selection. So let's see what you have selected. 58% of you say green, 42% of you save you, right? Of you say green, 40% of you say blue. And you have a pretty good sample size, 67 people. Maybe, yeah. Maybe we should stop voting now. Yes. All right, I will put it in the next slide. Let's see what happened actually. Of course, the green forecast was a better forecast in this case. But what would have happened if we have used forecast packets instead? Right? This is the question. Between the two lines, between the two forecasts. Exponential smoothing, simple exponential smoothing, and that. Let's see the values of AIC. AIC corrected version of AIC. So the lower the better, 679 for the blue, 680 for the green. So slightly better the blue line here. So the majority of you were better than the forecast packets in this particular case. So we can see that in some cases, judgmental model selection works, right? So in this work, in this study today, we will try to see some more results on this study, on this research, and actually have some more insights on why it works. Generally, on judgment and forecasting, there has been done a lot of research. First of all, on point forecasting, essentially, you are given a time series and you're not using any statistical methods, you're just producing a point forecast judgmentally. And, well, the consensus is that this does not really work. Then, we have a lot of research on judgmental adjustment. So we have a statistical forecast and then we adjust this upwards and downwards based on light of new information, based, for example, on information about promotions, which are not accounted by the statistical forecast. But in so many cases, demand planners are simply adjusting the forecasts without any information. There was a case study that I'm aware of in North America, where a manager was asking his demand planners to put a reason for why they're adjusting their forecasts. So among the reasons, there was promotion, or strike, or competitor's action, or this or that. But also at the end, he has something that's called NGR. So he told the demand planners, if you are not using any of the above actions, promotions, and this and that, just put NGR, okay? So after a few months, they got together to see how they went, and in the majority of the cases, the demand planners were using NGR. So he told them, NGR stands for no good reason. So please continue to do what you're doing, and in 2 months' time, we will come back here and do a review your progress again. So apparently, they stopped doing that. So in so many cases, people adjust for no good reason. So judgmental adjustments can work under some conditions, but in some other conditions, they do not work because of biases, because people try to take ownership, because they have some political agendas. Again, there's a lot of research on how we can produce judgmental probability forecasts or judgmental prediction intervals. We're not going to discuss about that. There is also work on how we can improve judgmental forecasts using decomposition, feedback, or even combination. But there is only one mention on judgmental model selection. Parent Wright, back in 91, they mentioned this, that this could be done, right? But they don't actually evaluate it. If we consider an IQ analogy of judgment forecasting with judgment, the judgmental point forecasting would be something like that. So we are given a time series and we are asked to produce what is the next square. Judgmental adjustment, we are given the fourth square, but we are asked to adjust it so it reflects correctly to the series. Judgmental model selection, we are given four alternatives for the last square, and we are asked to pick one of these four. And this study will focus on the latter. So we give some choices to the demand planners, 1, 2, 3, 4, these are statistical choices, statistical forecasts, and the demand plan is choose one of it. Actually, if you think about it, this is something that actually happens in practice. So I'm not referring this here. A typical forecasting support system looks like that. This is Focus Pro. So Focus Pro gives you the option to go for the so-called expert selection, which means I will do the job for you. I will select the best model for you, don't worry about it. But also, if you feel confident, you can go and select the model yourself. Exponential smoothing, single or fold or windows or whatever. So the option is there. And there is evidence that this option is taken by demand planners. So given that this is practice, the question is, how does this perform? And this is actually a research gap that we have identified. So generally, model selection, there are several approaches in statistics. Some people do model selection using information criteria, and this is actually also the packages that have been developed by Rob Hyman, AIC or BIC, or corrected AI, or corrected AIC. Some other people use validation or cross-validation. So essentially, they measure the performance of methods over past blocks of data and make the naive assumption that whatever worked well, it will continue to work well. Other people have focused on rule-based forecasting. So they have created a set of rules to select the best model for each case. So all of these approaches are statistical approaches. But in all these cases, all these approaches work based on past information. Okay? So they evaluate past information of the data. Either this is in sample or the sample that you have hidden to do your cross-validation, essentially the information you are using is up to today, whatever you do. Why do you expect that the judgmental model selection will work? Is that because a human can see the line that is produced by a statistical method and can actually evaluate if this looks reasonable or not. If I go back to the example, to the game that we played in the beginning of the presentation, the green line, at least in my viewpoint, appeared to be more reasonable extrapolation of the future, of the past. If a green line looks more reasonable or reasonably, this cannot be actually measured by statistics. But a human can actually evaluate that somehow, that judgmentally. So we believe that maybe the secret is hidden there, that maybe forecasters can select a method based on the quality of the out-of-sample forecasts. And this quality, we argue that currently we cannot really measure by the statistics. So we have on the one hand the brain, we will call it the brain, it's the human judgment, it's the judgmental model selection, and on the other hand we have the computer, which is the forecasting system, or the statistics, or automatic selection if you wish, and in our case it's based on information criteria. And the best hypothesis is that the brain performs model selection differently than the computer. We are not saying better or worse, we say differently. Hypothesis 2 is that the brain is better in building models than selecting one. So if we give just some choices to the demand planners, maybe they are not as good as if we ask them about the components of the time series. And this is based on the work that has previously been done on the composition. And hypothesis 3, we hypothesize that both combination between statistical and judgmental selection, but also aggregation of different selections across different demand planners, will outperform both brain and computer. So to check our hypothesis, we designed a laboratory experiment. We have two main factors. The first design is called model selection. And essentially, we provide the participants with four choices, model A, model B, model C, model D. We don't really name the, which models we are using. And if a model is selected, a forecast is drawn. If another model is selected, another forecast is drawn. And once they are happy with selection, they press submit and they go to the next time series. So half of the participants did that model selection. The other half did model build. So in this case, we don't ask model A or model B or model C, but we ask two simple questions. Does the time series have threat? Yes or no? Does the time series have seasonality? Yes or no? So these two simple questions. So they could select no trend, no seasonality, or they could select just trend or just seasonality or both. If you think about it, both cases have exactly four methods. And these four methods are the same between the two experiments, model selection and model build. And these four methods are simple cross smoothing, no trend, no seasonality, SES with seasonality, damped and damped with seasonality. And we ask for each participant to do one or the other experiment, and we provide 32 time series of real data from the energy competition, monthly data. And we are also using different types of information. So for each block of 8 time series, we have 4 blocks of 8 time series, we provide different types of information. So the most basic one, we just provide the out-of-sample forecast. Then we provide both the in-sampling and the out-of-sample forecast. The in-sampling is where the information criteria is calculated essentially. Then we provide the out-of-sample forecast, but also at this left bottom of the screen, we also provide something that we call the forecast error. It's actually the value of AIC, and we explain that the lower the better. So maybe some participants focus on that and select based on that. And in the fourth scenario, we essentially provide all of this. Our results have shown that there is no difference between these four, so we will not analyze for each of these separately. So our hypothesis is that the participants are mainly focused on how the forecast look like in the future. We were very lucky to be able to have for this experiment 700 participants, more or less. Mostly students, undergrads and postgrads, but also we had 90 practitioners. Some of you in this room have participated in this experiment a couple of years ago, or 3 years ago. And our participants come from all over the world, so we can confidently say that we have tackled any biases related to culture. So our first analysis of results concerns how individuals perform selections. And we have 4 selections, model A, model B, model C, model D, and each participant selects one model, and we assign a weight of 1 to this model. So first, we show the scores that the participants achieved through this exercise. How the scores calculated, we give 3 points if the selection was the best, 2 points if the selection was second best, 0 points if the selection was worst, the worst selection. So the maximum number of points is standardized to be 100 essentially, and we also calculate how the statistics would score. By the way, we chose the time series in a way so that in 16 half of our time series, AIC provides the best option, and in the other half of the time series, AIC does not provide the best option. In any case, statistics score 65 according to this selection score. And we can see in this image, in this graph, that model selection usually, normally, performs worse, lower than statistics. Statistics is the red line. Model build performs, on average, as good as statistics. The median is almost the same as the statistics. But also there is high variability across the different individuals. We also analyze in terms of how often humans versus statistics select the best or the worst make the best or the worst selection. So as you can see here, in both setups, selection, model selection and model build, humans select the best model less often than the statistics. But at the same time, in both setups, humans select the worst model less often than the statistics. And this means that maybe humans are not good in selecting the best model, but they are good in avoiding the worst model. And this goes back to how they evaluate the quality of the forecast they see. They would essentially, they would not select a model for which the forecast do not seem reasonable. How this translates to forecasting performance now? First, we calculate the bias using the mean percentage error. The closer to zero, the better. The closer to the gray horizontal line, the better. Both setups significantly outperform statistics in this case. When it comes to accuracy, we use May, S-May, and May. And in the case of May, both setups significantly outperform statistics. In S-May, model selection is worse, model build is as good as, and the same is the case for May. So generally, we can see that model build is better than model selection. And it seems that model build is either as good as on average or better than statistics, depending on the metrics. These results concern all the participants, all the 700 participants. But we also analyze with regards to our 90 practitioners to see if the results are better or worse or different, and maybe have some insights if we can still keep using students in our experiments. The insights we get here are more or less the same. Practitioners are better in terms of bias and make, as good as for S-May, but now, in terms of maze, they are also better than the, statistics for the model build approach. So we can say that our results generally have the same view as before, but also now we can say more confidently that if we are using practitioners, the practitioners will outperform the model selection, the statistical model selection, more often. Next, we analyze our results based on the combination approach. So we get what the participant said, and also we get what the computer said, and we apply equal weights to these two. So we don't believe either, we believe both equally. 50% statistics, 50% manager. This goes back to Blackberg and Hogg, 1990, in Management Science published. So how our results look like here? We remain significantly better than statistics for bias and make. Now the improvements are even better. But now we are also better significantly for both approaches, for model selection and model build. Another thing that happens if we opt for combination is that the difference between model selection and model build are minimized. Previously, model build was much better than model selection. Here, model build maybe and model selection are equally good, more or less. So if we opt for 50-50, almost all of the cases, we are better than statistics. We also analyze our results with regards to wisdom of crowds. And what we call here wisdom of crowds is essentially, instead of considering just one participant, we consider a group of participants. So let's say we have 20 demand planners and we ask them the same task, perform judgmental model selection for one time series, and some of them select A, some of them select B, and so on and so forth. So from that, we can essentially construct weights and apply these weights to different models. If we have 20 participants or 20 demand planners available for this task, the results would look something like that. Impressive, right? They beat statistics all the time, significantly all the box plots are better than the statistics. But of course, you would say, 20 experts? Who has 20 experts for one time series? Previously, Brian Seaman was telling that they tried to forecast 2 billion time series in Walmart, in the physical stores of Walmart. So you cannot really have 20 demand planners for forecasting one time series, right? So a question here is, how many do we need? How many of these do we need? So what we do? We do a sensitivity analysis, a robustness test if you wish, and we do this exercise for all number of group of experts, starting from one, this is individual selection, up to 50. And here are the results. You can see these blue areas as box plot, so the light blue areas would be the Q1 and Q4, whereas the dark blue areas would be the box of the box plot, if you think about it. So what we can see here is that two demand planners are enough so that the box is always better, the box of the box plot is always better than statistics. So the majority, 50%, is better than statistics. And with five experts, we are always better than the statistics. The five experts is not the first time that appears in the literature. This goes back to Aston and Aston papers, that they were saying that forecasts from five experts and combining them are enough to outperform everything else. So our suggestion here is wisdom of crowds or using judgmental selection with many demand planners maybe makes sense. But we have to be careful here because demand planners are still expensive. So overall, we have done, of course, other benchmarks. We have presented this presentation either in New York, Boston, and Nikos in quite a few universities. And we have received a lot of feedback on that. So once we were asked, what about if you do random selection, right? What if you randomly select a model instead of having participants selecting a model? And actually, this is the black line here. Worse, okay? The other thing we got a feedback from Monash a couple of years ago is what you do combination, is either simple combination, which you can see in this graph, or what if you do a combination using weights calculated from the Akaki information criteria. And this is some empirical work that Stefan has done 3 years ago, 6 years ago. And actually, we outperformed that as well. So we have done our sanity checks, if you wish. But still, the question here remains that if judgmental model built using the wisdom of crowds approach is the best, we still really can't apply it in the whole of our products or our SKUs. It's still quite expensive. So what we suggest here is before you apply this, maybe you should go for an ABC XYZ analysis. So analyze your products in terms of ABC is importance, A is the most important, C is the least important, but at the same time analyze in terms of forecastability XYZ. X is the most forecastable, Z is the least forecastable. And our approach here is that most possibly demand planners should focus using judgmental model selection. Maybe they should focus on the most important items and at the same time the least forecastable items. These are the AZ items. If we opt for the normal size of classes, 20, 30, 50% from the Pareto rule, this AZ class would be maybe 4% of the counts of your SKUs. So that's our proposition here. Maybe you should apply this judgmental selection approach, not on the majority of your SKUs, but only on the AZ products. So what we have found so far is that judgmental selection is a tool that has been offered by many forecasting support systems. But its performance has never been evaluated in practice, regardless of the fact that it's applied. And what we found, again, is that the judgmental model selection, and especially judgmental model build, can offer improvements over a statistical selection strategy. And the improvements are even more apparent if you focus on our practitioners, on our group of 90 practitioners, which maybe have more experience. The improvements I would like to see at this stage, there might be even more if the demand planners have knowledge of the time series. Maybe yes, maybe no, we have to check that, we don't know. In this case, the time series were not identified, what time series, which time series is which. But also, which is a group judgmental model selection, but also 50% combination, 50% combination approach, both of these appear to be very promising. But this work is not finished here. We are currently exploring new avenues. So what we are doing currently, we run a new experiment using brain imaging, and we do this experiment in China. So what we do, we have a simplified version of our experiment here using just two models, simple sensor smoothing and fold, so essentially we check trend or no trend. This is the model selection problem here. And while we are doing the same, while we are giving the same task to the practitioners, to the participants, what we do, we also capture the activity of the brain through electroencephalogram, EEG. So we put these 32 nodes on the brain and we capture how they think, how they operate while they do the task, while they do model selection, or while they do modeling. And we try to identify if there are differences between the one or the other approach. And here, in this video, I would like to focus on the middle and the third circuit, middle and third circuit. So the red essentially tells us where the brain activity happens, and the middle is the model selection approach, and the right third circuit, the right, is the model build approach. And you can see that during this experiment, during the 8 seconds of this experiment, brain activity is occurring in different places. So different parts of the brain are responsible for these different tasks. So we'd like to explore this further and see how this model selection and model build are translated in terms of brain activity, and then you can get some insights out of this. So maybe in the very future we can emulate this whole thing, and you can emulate how the human brain performs model selection, maybe to apply this to a batch manner. So that was it. Thank you so much.